In our previous videos, we learned about gene cloning. We saw how a gene of interest gets inside of a vector and through transformation gets inside of a host cell. Well, all this takes place inside a test tube, and by the end of the process, we expect that in the test tube, we will get cells of this three possible genetic makeup. So we will have cells that has the recombinant DNA. We will also have cells that has the empty plasmid, and we will also have cells that has not taken up anything at all. Now, we do not want these two types of cells to grow any further because we are interested in the gene that we care about, and that is present in this first type of cell that has the recombinant DNA. Now, the question is, how do we select this type of cells from millions and billions of cells that are present in the test tube? Well, there comes the savior, that is selectable marker. Well, this selectable marker are genes in the plasmid, and in this video we will see how they help us to isolate the type of cells we want. Now, before we even jump into the process of selecting the type of cells we want, we need to let the bacterial cells grow in a petri dish. We'll have to pour a little bit of content from the test tube into a petri dish having nutrient medium. And what will happen after that? If you leave it overnight, you will see that the next morning your petri dish is full of bacterial colonies. Now, these bacterial colonies are formed by division of bacterial cells, and millions of bacterial cells pile one above the other to give the appearance of the circular patches you see here. Now, for the ease of understanding, let's say we just have 5 colonies. Now, the interesting thing about bacterial colonies is that every single cell in a colony is an identical copy of each other. It is an exact replica of one another. As bacterial cells do not undergo sexual reproduction, there is no variation, and therefore every single cell in a colony will be the same. Let's say if we extract one cell from this colony and it has only an empty plasmid inside of it, that means every single cell of that colony will have only the empty plasmid. Well, having said that, let's just consider that the recombinant DNA is present in cells of this particular colony. Say, let me number them. Let's say this is colony 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So the first and second colony has cells with recombinant DNA. So let me number these cells as well. And let's say the third and fourth colony has cells which is just the empty plasmid. So third and fourth colony has this type of cells, and the fifth colony has cells that has nothing inside of it. Let's say this is the type of cell present in the fifth colony. Well, now our goal should be to extract the first and the second colony, but how would we know that in a lab? How would we differentiate? Well, what about we find out a way to stop the growth of the other three colonies, the third, fourth, and fifth one? Or maybe how about find a way to just kill them? Well, we know about a chemical substance that kills or stops the growth of bacterial cells, and that is antibiotics. How about we go ahead and put some antibiotics into the medium? Well, wait, won't that kill the first and the second colonies as well? Because those are bacterial colonies too, and we do not want those colonies to die because it has the recombinant DNA. So what should we do next? How about while designing the plasmid, we put in a gene that would give resistance to antibiotic? To be specific, let's say the antibiotic we are using here is ampicillin. A fancy name given to an antibiotic. Well, how about while designing the vector, we put in an ampicillin resistance gene inside of it? That way, when we pour in ampicillin in the medium, any cell that has the vector inside of it will be able to grow, but cells that has not taken up the vector will not be able to grow in the medium. So that way we can get rid of this type of cell, the cell that has not taken up the vector. Which means that we can get rid of this fifth colony. But wait, the problem is not solved yet. We still have colonies with two different type of cells. And if you can see, both these cells has the vector inside of it. And as we have inserted the ampicillin resistance gene, they have the ampicillin resistance gene inside those vectors. So put this vector has the ampicillin resistance gene inside of it. Well, now the question is, how do we differentiate between the two? Because both the cells have the vector inside of it, and making any further change in the vector would create the change in both the cells. This is when scientists came up with an idea of inserting another antibiotic resistance gene into the vector. Say the antibiotic resistance gene here is for tetracycline. Cycline, this is another fancy name for another antibiotic, and this gene here is resistant to the tetracycline antibiotic. Well, now you may think, how is that even helping us? Both our cells now are resistant to another antibiotic, which is tetracycline, but how is that even helping us differentiate between the two? Well, here comes the masterstroke of the scientist. What they did, they inserted the multiple cloning sites inside this tetracycline resistance gene. Now, if you can recall from our previous video, we discussed about multiple cloning sites. Those were sites in which we put in the gene of interest. Now, when the multiple cloning site is situated inside of another gene, here it is the tetracycline resistance gene, it inactivates the gene that was previously there. Well, to tell you in simple words, it is similar to inserting a new word inside another word. For example, if we take the word tetracycline and we divide it into two and we insert a new word, say insulin here, now the word that was previously there loses its meaning. I mean, tet and racycline individually makes no sense, right? Similarly, when we insert a new gene inside of another gene that was previously there becomes inactive. And that inactivation was caused by the insertion of new gene, right? So we call it insertional inactivation. And this insertional inactivation will take place in any cell that has the insert inside of it. Which means the tetracycline resistance, R here stands for resistance, so the resistance power of tetracycline will be lost by any plasmid that has the gene of interest inserted inside of it. So the recombinant cell that has the insert inside of it will not have tetracycline resistance. Now can you think what might happen if we allow both these cells to grow in the presence of tetracycline? Can you pause for a while and think about it? Now in the presence of tetracycline, any cell that do not have the resistance power would die. Now as we have inactivated the resistance power in the recombinant DNA, the cells having the recombinant gene would die, which means the first and the second colony will die, or we may say they would stop growing. But wait, do we even want them to stop growing? Because these were the two colonies we ultimately focused on extracting of this petri dish, right? These colonies had the recombinant DNA, but now what we have done is stop the growth of this recombinant cells. Well, you need not freak out because we take care of it in the lab. Let me show you how it is done. So what happens is we keep this plate untouched. We keep it as a master plate. Let me write it down. This is a master plate. Just like we make photocopies of important documents, we create replica plates. Now, you need not worry about how do we create them because that's not very important. What's important is in both these petri dishes along with nutrient medium, we now have antibiotics in here. In the first petri dish, we have ampicillin, and in the second petri dish, we have tetracycline. Now how about you pause for a while and think about the fate of these colonies in both the petri dish. Alright, let's start with the fifth colony, the colony that has not taken up the vector. Since it has got no vector, it has no gene for ampicillin resistance and no gene for tetracycline resistance. Therefore, it won't grow in both the petri dishes. So the fifth colony won't grow in both the petri dishes. Alright, what about the third and the fourth colony? These colonies have cells with empty plasmid. That means it has an ampicillin resistance gene intact. That means it would grow in the presence of ampicillin and it has an intact tetracycline resistance gene, which means it will be able to grow in the presence of tetracycline. All right, what about the first and the second colony, the cells that has the recombinant DNA inside of it? What will it do in the presence of ampicillin? Since it has an ampicillin resistance gene intact inside of it, it will be able to grow in the presence of ampicillin. But then due to insertional inactivation, we have inactivated the tetracycline resistance gene, right? Therefore, it won't grow in the presence of tetracycline. All right, while working in a lab, we will not have the information of which cells are present in which of these colonies. Let me get rid of these numbers first. Okay, so the only information we will have is what vectors we are using, what genes are present in our vector, and where is the multiple cloning site where the insertional inactivation would occur. Well, just with those information, we need to tell which of these colonies has the recombinant DNA just by looking at these two petri dishes. All right, let's try to do that. When we look at the first petri dish, we'll see that the first, second, third, and fourth colony are growing fine. So that means it has resistance to ampicillin, and that is possible only if they have taken in the vector. But the fifth colony is not growing in the presence of ampicillin. That means they have cells that did not ingest the vector. All right, now let's look at the second petri dish. Even here, the fifth colony is not growing. That means it has not taken in the vector, no resistance against tetracycline as well. Now, the third and the fourth colony seems to be doing just fine even here. It has a tetracycline resistance gene intact. But the difference is in the first and the second colony, it's growing in the presence of ampicillin, but not growing in the presence of tetracycline. Interesting, right? So what must have happened? The insertional inactivation must have happened that has inactivated the tetracycline resistance gene. This also means that it has the gene of interest inside of it. So these are the two colonies that we would want to extract. Now that we know the first and the second colony has the cells with recombinant DNA inside of it, we can go ahead and extract those colonies from the master plate and carry on the experiment with it. Alright, now if you look back and see what actually helped you to select the first and second colonies, it was actually the antibiotic resistance gene in the vector, the ampicillin resistance gene, and the tetracycline resistance gene. So we call these genes as selectable markers. Alright, this was all about antibiotic acting as selectable markers. And now after watching this video, you should now be able to tell what is a selectable marker, how antibiotic resistance gene act as selectable markers, and what is insertional inactivation. Now, if you're not able to answer any of these, you can always go back and watch the video.